up. Wow, wow, wow. Welcome to Wildlife, everyone. My name is Kelly, and I'm just so... Wow. In case some of you guys don't know, Wildlife is the name of our middle school ministry that Haley is the producer for, and she's amazing. She makes sure that she... Revolution! Oh, man! I can't keep up with you guys. Christian is the producer for Wildlife. My bad. Anyways, I'm going to stick to preaching today, so I'm going to just keep it real simple. We're in a series called I Quit. We're not asking you to quit your jobs, quit your, you know, girlfriends or boyfriends, which you might have to, or quit anything else. What we are asking you to do is quit some of your bad habits. The, you know, Jesus asked us to follow him. And so this life of following Jesus is actually described in the Bible as a marathon. And nobody runs a marathon with unnecessary equipment. Or maybe somebody does, but I wouldn't, right? Nobody runs a marathon with, you know, extra weights on them or extra bags or extra shoes or even with someone strapped on their back, like running like this. Like, nobody runs a marathon like that. In order to run a marathon, we need to let go of the things that what? Hinder. We let go of the things that hinder. And so we've identified four things that hinder you from walking in the fullness of what God has called you. The first thing is, I'm asking you to quit comparing yourselves to other people. The next thing we're asking is that you would quit living in fear. And then the next, we're asking you to quit making excuses. Man, excuses. They're so bad, they get you every time. And today we're talking about quitting complaining. Somebody say, aw. That's what complaining sounds like. You know, we live in a society that some authors call the complaining generation. The complaining generation, which is ironic because the people who are complaining about our generation are themselves complaining. Oddly enough. And so I just want to do a little experiment with you guys. All right? So from this part of the building on, so like Johnny on that way, I want you guys, when I say so, to tell the person next to you what you are grateful for. Just one thing that you're grateful for. It could be like toilet paper or, you know, buttons. This side, I want you guys to tell one another one thing that you're complaining about these days, okay? You know what it is. I don't have to give you examples. I'm sure something already came to your mind. All right, here we go. One, two, three, go. All right, five, four, three, two. Somebody ask Taylor. Somebody ask Taylor. Five, four, three, two, one, done. All right, how many of y'all feel great about what you just did? My gratitude side, where you at? Come on, thankfulness people. Right, so I noticed that most of the complaining side doesn't necessarily feel as good about it. But unless you really had something to get off your chest, you're like, hey, I really need to let you know. But the reality is that complaining gets us, takes us backwards and not forwards, right? Complaining truly does. And I went on Facebook, and which is every, you know, 4 hours, and I sent out a post to people. Maybe you guys remember, I put it on Instagram too, and I took a picture of what I was reading at the time, and I said, hey, I'm doing a sermon on complaining. Can any of you just go ahead and write down what you are complaining about right now? And I got some really interesting answers. Do you guys want to hear what they said? Yeah. Okay. The first thing someone said is that they complain about long sermons. So shut up. I know, that's ratchet. Come on. All right. The next thing someone said is, I complain about people complaining. That's funny. A lot of people actually said they complain about money. Too much money at the end of the month. Or too much month at the end of the money. I think that's what they said. One person said, I complain about traffic. Oh, gosh, how many? I'm in the same boat. Someone complained about gluten. Like... Dang you, gluten! It's probably glutton. Yeah, I just spelled it wrong.
I just read it right.
I complained about Starbucks. People complained about rain. Somebody complained about droughts. People complained about work. A lot of people complained about work. Oh, someone complained about this. Drivers who don't use their blinkers. Yes. That's an epidemic. That's not a problem. That's my problem. I'll start using my blinkers. One person complained about millennials. I said, one person complained about being busy. And one person said they're sick and tired of being sick and tired. And last week, someone complained about their iguana exploding. And if you listen to the YouTube, go on YouTube, listen to last week's message. Chris Wozniacki complained about his iguana exploding. But the truth is, how many of you know people who complain a lot? And if you don't know people who complain a lot, then guess what? You're the complainer. And so the question I want us all to ask ourselves is, how do we stop the complaining trap? How do we stop complaining in life? How do we make the most of our life and stop being a burden on other people with our burdens? So let's pray as we get started. Father, we know that you have a message prepared for us, and I pray that you would speak through my mouth. And I pray that your words would not just land in people's minds, but it would travel into their hearts. And not just live in their hearts, but be lived out in their actions. I pray that these people tonight would leave with more Jesus than they came with. I pray for the people that are watching on YouTube, that they would leave with more Jesus than they came with. In Jesus' name, amen. As we start this conversation about complaining, I want you to know that I'm going to use the term grumbling and complaining pretty much synonymous, same word. So grumbling and complaining, I'm going to use that word interchangeably. And as we get into this conversation, the message is not, don't worry, be happy now. That is not the message. That is not the message, because I know that people came in here with burdens. And that is not the message that God wants to communicate to you, right? God recognizes your groans. That's another G word. He recognizes the things, the trials, the temptations, the hardships in your life, and he does not underestimate those. The things that you care about, guess what? He cares about it. He knows everything about you. The Bible says in Jeremiah that he knows every single hair that is on top of your head, or the lack of hair that is on top of your head. But he cares. So I do not want you to get it messed up. That just because I'm telling you not to complain doesn't mean that you don't have real burdens. So the first G, there's three G's in this sermon. So if you're taking notes, you can write the first G down. The first G that I want us to understand. Oh, I thought that was going to be way more slicker than that. Oh, dang. It's the wrong one. One of these is right. Okay, cool. The first G is groaning, 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 groaning. Somebody's saying, groaning. Okay, so first of all, thank you, Caitlin Harrison, for making these banners for me. I appreciate it. Because those of you who are sitting at home watching on the YouTube, you can't see the screens, but at least we have little visual representations for you. And so the first G is groaning, if you're following along. And so groaning is actually something that the Bible encourages. Groaning is something that God listens to. And groaning is something that the Israelites did in Egypt when they were enslaved, when they were in bondage, when they were oppressed, when they were hurting. So what they did was groan to God. Groaning is something we do to our Father. And this is how he responds. It says in Exodus 2:23-24, Exodus 2:23, it says, during that long period, the king of Egypt died. The Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out. And in their cry for help, because of their slavery, their cries went up to God. God heard their groaning, and he remembered, somebody say remembered, his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So God looked down on the Israelites with concern about them. God looked down on the Israelites with concern about them. Groaning is something that we do to God, and he welcomes it. He welcomes it. And the interesting thing about this is that the Israelites cried out, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And the interesting thing is, the contrast in this passage is that God remembered, but the Egyptian king did not remember. See, the reason why the Israelites were in Egypt was because, you know, Joseph in the technicolor green coat? technicolored dream coat, right? Joseph brought his family into Egypt because he had a lot of influence and then resurrected pretty much what, you know, a dying race out of Egypt. But the king of Egypt that was around during Joseph's time, well, he done died. And they forgot. The Egyptian kings forgot about Joseph and that covenant. But God remembered the covenant between Egypt or between Israelites and him. And so God remembered. And God was concerned. It's a sobering thought. It's a sobering thought to me that God actually heard the Israelites. It's a sobering thought because here's the thing. A lot of times when people don't feel heard, what do they do? What do babies do when they don't get what they want? They cry. They throw temper tantrums. So what do adults do when they don't get what they want? Sometimes they cry and they don't do this. Yeah, they rebel, right? They rebel against whatever authority they think is not listening to them. And that's why we have peaceful protests. Hopefully they stay peaceful. But sometimes when those protests are not peaceful and people continue to be ignored, those protests become riots. They start to get violent. And in this particular cultural climate, we are in a situation where there is a group of people who do not feel heard. I actually had a question about why do riots take place? I was around during the 94 riots. You guys probably, some of you weren't even born in 94 when the Rodney King beating happened and there was a bunch of riots. But right now you're alive during a time where people are rioting in Washington. So it's a similar situation where you have a group of people who don't feel heard. And so because they don't feel heard, they throw a massive temper tantrum, right? And some of that is justified because if you are an oppressed person and you're constantly being ignored and you can't get, you know, justice, right? And you appeal for justice and you go up the political ladder and you get your votes and you do your things and you're constantly not getting justice, well, then you were supposed to stand up for what you believe in. You should. And you should do it peacefully, though. But when a group of people don't have a voice, sometimes they take it out violently. And I just needed to understand that. And so I asked a friend, his name, he was like a Christian rapper, he's a really smart guy named Propaganda. And I was asking him about, why do people riot? And he was telling me about how, like, all these, like it was during Martin Luther King Day, and I was asking him about that, and he was explaining to me that rioting is a voice of for people who are simply not being heard. And in this particular passage, you have a group of people who are oppressed, completely oppressed. They're being beaten, they're being taken advantage of, and they have no voice in this society. But there's one person who hears them, and that's God. And the sobering thought is, because of the covenant that we have through Jesus Christ, God hears our cries too. God hears your groans too. That even if you feel like you're in a voiceless situation, which you may very well be in a voiceless situation, especially in our current cultural climate, let me tell you, just because our government is not listening to you does not mean that God is not. Groaning is something that is welcomed. And I want you to know that. I don't want that to go away. And groaning is something that that creation is doing. Actually, Romans 8 says, we know that the whole creation has been groaning as in pains of childbirth right up until this present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have been the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for the adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we have been saved. Skipping to 25. But we hope for what we do not yet have. We wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. I just want to say that again. Somebody needs to hear that. The Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. Wordless groans. Even if you don't know how to pray, God intercedes for the noises that you make that don't make sense. There's three different types of groaning. Creation groans. The saints that are being persecuted are groaning. And then the Spirit groans. So I want you to know, if you came here with a burden, we have a prayer corner, and God is listening to your groans. All right? That's the first G. All right. Now let's talk about grumbling. All right? The first G. The second G, grumbling. Oh, I think I know where this one is now. Grumbling. Grumbling for you YouTube family at home. Awesome, awesome. By the way, we still need 50 more subscribers for YouTube in order for us to have our own personal URL. So hook a brother up. All right. Grumble, 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 grumble. So grumbling, grumbling, grumbling. Wow. Grumbling is just, there's so many things I want to say, but let me just go in the order that I wrote it down first. So let's go ahead and look at Exodus again. So Exodus 16. The whole Israelite community paused. Let me give you some context about this. So God provided a savior, Moses, to get these Israelites out of Egypt, and now they are in the desert, right? So God did crazy miracles, got them out of Egypt, and walked them through the Dead Sea, or Red Sea. Dead Sea, thank you. Dead Sea. For a second, I had to pause and figure that out. Thank you, guys. You guys are smart. Is it Red Sea? Oh, so I was right. All right, Google it. God walked them through the sea, okay? God walked them through the sea. Part of the sea, they walked through on dry ground, miracle themselves, and they're out in the desert. God is making provision for them. And then their groans turned into what? Grumbling. Here we go. Exodus 16, 1 through 3. The whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the desert of Sin. Someone say Sin. Ooh. Which is between Elim and Sinai. And everybody knows what happens in Mount Sinai. And on the 15th day, on the second month, after they had come out of Egypt, this is all going down, in the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, if only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into the desert to starve to death. First thing you need to know is that the desert of sin is literally, this is where they ended up sinning a lot, right? This is the desert of sin. NIV calls it sin, but another translation is actually zin. So there's actually no like theological significance for that, but I thought I should tell you that. I just thought it was cool. So here's the thing. Groaning is something we do to God. Grumbling is something we kind of do behind God's back and we do to other people. See, groaning is something we do to God, and grumbling is something that we do behind God's back to other people. And you see here, the whole assembly grumbled against who? Moses and Aaron. See, I understand that their grumbling is partially justified because it is in the desert, but not at the cost of becoming a slave again. That makes no sense. See, when we grumble, it makes a long journey longer and also disillusions us from the freedom that we have. It turns freedom into bondage, but it becomes a bondage in our mind. I'll say that again. Grumbling turns freedom into bondage, but the bondage is in our mind. See, they became disillusioned about the salvation they just experienced, and yet they want to go back. Like I said earlier, complaining, grumbling takes you backwards and not forwards. There's three things I want you to know, or actually four things I want you to know about complaining. Complaining will always make you forget the freedom you came from. Complaining will always turn your freedom into bondage. And third, complaining will always make a long journey longer. It will. It definitely will. I went to go see a concert a couple years back, and it was a huge concert. I mean, it was JT, Jay-Z, and Beyonce showed up all in the same place. I mean, this place was packed out. And there was, like, I don't want to say hundreds of thousands of people, but there was, like, at least over 50,000 people in this place for this concert. And I, you know, got the tickets, and I brought some friends, and we rented a party bus, and it was like me and a bunch of church family people. We went all the way to like the Rose Bowl or something, and we saw this concert. It was a little questionable about what Beyonce was doing, but I was like, whatever. And and on the way out, everyone's trying to go home. So what the police did was block the entrance off like four blocks around, at least four blocks around all the whole venue. And so our bus could not pick us up. So we either needed to walk 45 minutes or wait 3 hours until everything cleared up. So what do you think we did? We walked 45 minutes, or at least that was the plan. And on the way to our bus, one of the people in my like train of like people we were leading to the bus, she was like kind of getting hangry. You know, hangry. You know, when you're hungry and angry is hangry. And she was like, why do we have to walk so far? Can't we just wait here and get a taxi? My feet hurt. I'm hungry. My iguana exploded. Like she was just turning a long situation, like really long. Like that was the longest 45 minutes of my life, right? And that's what complaining does. And this is, and for the Israelite community, see, I'm talking about walking away from a concert. I'm talking about a 45-minute walk that just felt like 3 hours. But this is literally not even 3 months after the Israelites came out of Egypt. I mean, the scars are still welts on their back, and they're thinking about going back into slavery because their tummy is rumbly. You know, like, seriously, this is a nomadic tribe. Like, so these Israelites wanted to go back into slavery, and they were disillusioned, thinking that there's pots of meat, and we got to eat whatever we want. Egypt was great. Not. Like, they were completely disillusioned, and that's exactly what grumbling does. And it makes a long journey longer. You know what else complaining does? It offends. It offends your provider. Complaining is an offense to God, our creator, our provider. If you're writing stuff down, I would write that. But complaining is an offense to your creator. Numbers 14. This is, oh man, gosh. God showed so much patience to Israel. If you don't read Exodus and Numbers, which normally I don't, but in this particular situation, I couldn't get enough of it because it's such a mirror image of my relationship with God. After they're complaining, God hooks them up with manna from heaven. Have you ever heard of the word manna? Manna. What manna was in the desert is this, literally, food from heaven came down and provided, literally, like another, this is a complete miracle. So, you know, not to mention they got out of Egypt, God provided two guys to save a nation out of Egypt. That's crazy cool. Then God opened up a sea. We haven't figured out which sea it is yet. Either the red one, the dead one. All right, whatever. We'll figure it out. I'll Google it and I'll let you know. It's the Red Sea. Thank you. Now we know it's the Red Sea. YouTube, I'm smarter than this. So miracle, boom. Oceans, you know, the sea opens up, Red Sea, people walking through, and then they're in the desert, and then they're complaining, and God provides food that magically appears every morning. Boom, angel food cake right there. Awesome, right? Because it's from heaven, angel. I know, it's so punny. And so, yeah, it's not a chimichanga, which that would have been awesome too. So people are eating this food, and now they've been eating this food for many, 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 many months, many years, possibly. And they start getting like, you know, like they start yelping other foods and be like, hey, can't we just have what we had in, you know, Egypt, you know, again? Why can't we go back there? And this is them complaining again against God. And this is how God feels when we complain about his provision. Key word here is provision. Numbers 14:11 says this, the Lord said to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? Someone say contempt. How long will they refuse to believe in me? In spite of all my signs I have performed among them, I will strike them down and plague them and destroy them, but I will make you into a great nation. And in the wilderness, your bodies will fall, every one of you, 20 years or older. And any of you, anyone who is counted in the census who grumbled against me. God takes complaining very seriously because it shows contempt for the one who's providing for you. Contempt means that you believe your way is better than their way. Contempt is sometimes is pretty much how most relationships end. Contempt is when you believe somebody is less than you. Every divorce, every broken relationship usually ends in contempt. And when we believe that God's provision isn't good enough, it shows him contempt. And complaining is actually a sign of disbelief, right? It says, "They, you know, how long will they refuse to believe me? In spite of all the signs." That's what it says there. Contempt is a sign of disbelief. Let me just tell you, there's no number of miraculous signs God can ever do to make you believe in him. These Israelites were flooded with miraculous signs. But yet these miraculous signs did not produce belief. It produced spoiled kids in the desert. That's what it did. You think, I talked with people last week, or even this week, and they say, hey, if God would just give me a sign, I would believe him. If he would just speak to me, I would believe him. All I need is for him to, like, you know, open up the clouds and say, hi, like, then I would believe him, right? That's all I need. I mean, just even literally, like, manna from heaven, like fiery clouds, or, you know, parting the Red Sea, or, you know, convincing somebody with a Jedi mind trick to release, like, captive prisoners. Like some sign, then I would believe. But if these Israelites didn't believe, what makes you think that you are going to believe? And first of all, if a miraculous sign did happen, how do you know that you would actually believe it and not be a skeptic? Because, like, with modern technology and science, like, there's, like, no way that I'm going to take a quote-unquote miracle for face value. So how would you even know if you don't even believe in God and you expect him to show up in a miracle? Signs don't produce believers. Signs spoil us sometimes. So if you're here today and you're looking for a miracle, man, I really hope God does that. But even greater the miracle, I want you to understand this. I want you to understand this. Please, please, please understand this. If you're waiting for God to speak to you, I know that he will, and he does. But because you exist within time and space, and God exists outside of time and space, you guys understand that? Right? You are limited by time and space, and I got 7 minutes, so that's time. Right? And God is not limited by that. Is it possible, because God is not limited by time and space, that he already spoke to you 2,000 years ago when the word became flesh and made his dwelling among us? Is that possible? Is it possible that in the beginning was the word, and the word became flesh and made his dwelling among us? And that word spoke to us through the person of Jesus Christ? A literal walking miracle, a literal dying and resurrecting miracle. Miracles don't necessarily make us believers. It didn't make these people believers, and I don't know if you're waiting for a sign to believe, I don't know if that's going to happen. I don't know if that's going to be your story. I don't know if that's going to be your experience, but if it does, great. I hope so. But let me tell you that this Bible is a miracle, and God did speak to you. And even if God does not say anything to you, he would still be justified. You would still be responsible, and he would still be good. Complaining is an offense to your provider. I live with a dog named Louie. It's the cutest biggest rodent you've ever seen. And Louie is he's fat. Like, Louie's just fat. Like, his owner feeds it all the time, walks it, bathes it, and petting it, I consider that a massage. And no matter how much this dog is eating, if I'm in the kitchen eating, guess what? The dog wants my food too. And I always, the same conversation, like this dog speaks English, I always look at it and I say, you ungrateful pup, haven't you eaten enough? No. He doesn't respond. He's just like, what, you have something for me? And he just whines. He just whines the whole time. Like, seriously. Now that's funny because it's Louie, but I know that we do that with, you know, our current situation. Now, I'm going to be real serious right now. Every person in this room has been provided. You've been provided with singleness, or you've been provided with marriage, one or the other. But nevertheless, both are a provision that we should not complain about any longer. And if you walk away from this message knowing one thing, both God provided for you. Those are good things, singleness or marriage. And if you choose to complain about your singleness, guess what's going to become worse? Your singleness is just going to become worse. And if you complain about your marriage is going to become worse. And when you complain, you show contempt for what God has provided for you. Singleness is a provision. The only worse thing than being single and wanting to be married is being married and wanting to be single. So don't try to rush God's hand into anything. God is providing for you. You might feel like you are in a desert. And there may be a lot of sin around you, especially if you're single. There's a lot of sin around you. And you're in the desert of sin. But the worst thing you can do is complain about your singleness, about your job, about your school, about your living situation. It only makes a bad situation worse. And complaining doesn't hurt you. It offends your Creator also. I don't want you to think that this is any less of a sin than anything else. Sin offends your Creator. And then more practically, complaining gives you spiritual bad breath. It really does. Complaining gives you spiritual bad breath. You have a friend, if you probably have multiple friends that complain a lot, but I'm guessing you have a friend that complains, and it's kind of hard to hang out with her or him after a while because all they do is complain about what they don't have. And even in your own self, you're thinking about the things that you don't have, and you're like, why are you complaining about dropping your iPhone 7 in the water? It's waterproof. And, why are you complaining about, not having the latest and greatest drone? Or why are you complaining? Like, in your mind, you're like, you know what? This person has social bad breath. Every time this person talks to me, I'm like, ugh. You know? You have friends like that. I know you do. It's so funny. And people always ask, how are you doing? And I sometimes play. I mean, this is a little divergent, but I always play with the Jack in the Box people because they're always like, how are you? Welcome to Jack in the Box. I always say, I don't want to talk about it. I'll get a number 3. So, like, I never want to tell them how I'm really doing. I don't want to talk to them about how I'm really doing. And sometimes we need to show some social etiquette because people are not always asking how you are really doing, especially if you don't have a relationship with them. You know, so you want to be careful. You know, develop some emotional IQ and choose the people that you want to be vulnerable with. All right? It's called emotional IQ. Well, I call it EQ. I think people call it EQ. But complaining gives you social bad breath. It just does. It offends God, and it's also offensive to people. So how do we quit complaining? Let me get to the answer. I got some time. Let me see. How do we quit complaining? There's two ways we choose to stop complaining. We can do it externally, or we can do it internally, right? Externally, we try to control our circumstances. So we make sure that we marry a person that we can control, and we can fix them as we go along, and that's great, and that usually works out, I'm sure. And Or we try to get a job with a boss. You know, maybe, you know, if you want to make sure you don't complain, get a job with a boss that asks you, how much do you want to make every 4 weeks? You know, just like, hey, whatever you want to get paid, sure, I'll put that in your check. Or maybe you try to find a teacher that grades really easy. Or maybe you want to find a teacher that asks you what kind of grade you want to get. And then lastly, you make sure that all your family members are in therapy. And that's one way. That's one way we can make sure that we don't complain. That's one way. But that's not realistic, is it? No. You will drive yourself crazy trying to control the world around you that's so uncontrollable. The second way that I particularly recommend is changing your internal world. You can change your external world, but you can definitely change your internal world. You can start with the heart, because the heart of the matter is the matter of the heart. The heart of this matter is a matter of the heart. So you can change your internal world. Luke 6 says, a good man brings good things out of the treasures in his what? Heart. But an evil man brings evil things out of the treasures in his heart. For out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if you find yourself speaking complaints, it's a heart issue. It's not an external issue. It's a heart issue. People ask me all the time, how do I, you know, manage, you know, the music that I listen to, because I do a lot of events. How do I manage that? Because, like, you have to listen to secular music, and secular just means radio music, I guess. I don't know what secular means other than not Christian, or non-religious music. But so I don't necessarily always listen to worship music all the time. So they're like, well, how do you manage that, your mind? Because there's a rule, you know, in the church world, and the rule is garbage in, garbage out, right? So if you put garbage in your mind, well, that's usually a reflection. It's going to actually affect the way you speak and the way you act, which I do tend to agree, because it says right here, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. So early on, when I came to church for the first time, right, I never listened to Christian music. In fact, I used to listen to, like, Dr. Dre, Snoop, you know, and like, you know, NWA, which stands for Ninjas with Attitudes. And that was the extent of the mental, that was always constantly going in my mind. That was my daily, you know, mental diet of music. And then I showed up into that F building. The building is right next, or two stories over. And I show up, and there's, like, this youth group, and they're, like, singing songs like, God forgives and we forget. Can. I'm like, they're jumping around there, because they're singing songs like, we're so happy. And I'm like, dude, these happy, clappy Christians, this is so cheesy. This is not Snoop, this is not Dre, this is not what I signed up. This is not Eazy-E, this is not DJ Quick, this is nothing. Nothing I listen to. It's like happy clappy music. So I didn't necessarily have, like, the most positive experience, like, listening to Christian music at first. But then I realized this music started to change the way I thought about God, about people around me, and it would be in my mind. I wouldn't, like, sing it out loud because I was, like, too embarrassed. And you would too, even, like, the music that back then, you probably would not. But the principle is that I slowly stopped listening to the things that influenced me, and I started to let myself be influenced by something that was going to change my heart. And it didn't matter whether or not I liked it. It just didn't. Because I wanted my heart to change. You see what I'm saying? Because I wanted to change my heart. I really wanted to change my heart, and the only way that was going to happen is by letting my heart be influenced by podcasts, by sermons, by worship music. Now, today, I love worship music. I really do. I especially love it when Jordan leads us. Don't you guys? Don't you love it when Jordan leads us? So, when we groan, I just recap, when we groan and we direct it towards God, He is listening. But when our groans are directed towards other people, well, that becomes grumbling. And the way we quit grumbling is start with the heart. But the way we defeat grumbling, finally. Oh. is by having an attitude of gratitude. And that's not how you spell attitude, but that's okay. All right? But this is how you spell gratitude. Thank you, Caitlin. All right, so gratitude. I don't know if attitude is ingratitude, but I just had Caitlin, you know, highlight that part because it's true. See, Psalm 100 says this, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God, and it is he who made us. And we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise him for his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues throughout all generations." And then the crowd goes wild. But it's true, right? We get more excited about a guy hitting a ball with a stick or someone holding a football wearing spandex than we do when we hear God's word. Don't picture me in spandex. I'm just saying. Like, we get more excited. Like, I don't know if it's an unconditional response, but our involuntary response to a crowd of people in a sports arena, right? Those people know how to worship. They are responding to what they value most. And when it comes to a song of praise, like, we can respond that way because God is good. Have you ever had a password you couldn't figure out, right? Have you ever had a password you can't figure out and you're like, okay, Yahoo, I'm trying to figure this out. Like, you must be the one that's messed up. And then you start grumbling and complaining about it. But a password gives you access. Password gives you access to your emails or to your Netflix account or whatever. If you are in Christ, guess what gets you into his presence? Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is the password. Thank you is the password. Gratitude is the password. And you know what? Don't start being grateful when you feel like it, because you never feel yourself into an action. You only act yourself into a feeling. Kind of like working out, right? You know, I don't necessarily ever feel like working out, for that matter, ever. But when I do, I feel great. And after habits starts to build, I start to want to work out. But I have to act myself into a feeling. I don't feel my way into an action. And so if you find yourself complaining a lot and you want to change your attitude to gratitude, you have to choose to come into his presence with thanksgiving. Enter into his courts with praise. Say that the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. As we close up shop, I'm going to invite the band up. Just to recap as we finish up. When your groans are directed towards God, it's groaning. And when your groans are directed towards people, it's grumbling. And the way we stop complaining is that we start with changing our heart. And we can defeat grumbling with gratitude. We can defeat grumbling with gratitude. Only gratitude will guide you through the wilderness of grumbling. Only gratitude will guide you out of the wilderness of grumbling. And there's three ways. Three ways to start practicing gratitude. The first thing is that, have you ever woke up on the wrong side of the bed? That's because you probably fell asleep on the wrong side. Mentally and possibly physically. But if you go to bed with a bad attitude, thinking about all the bad things that happened in your life, you're most likely going to wake up with the residue from the night before. And so one of the ways that I practice gratitude is, no matter how bad things were that day, I'll still write in my journal one good thing before I go to sleep. Literally, the last thing I wrote is a nice bed to sleep in. Like this, like, I'm not a journaler. I don't write. Like, you can't even read this. Like, I feel totally safe with you guys stealing my journal, because good luck. But if you start the practice of gratitude, at least right before you go to bed, it'll change your attitude in the morning. Remember, we're trying to act our way into a feeling. I'm not asking you to do it when you feel like doing it. I'm asking you to make a decision starting tonight to take a piece of paper, write, thank you for my bed, and see what it does for you. The second way I want you to practice gratitude is not eat. I know, that's weird. Fasting is a practice that I use to get my mind right, to get my heart right. Fasting is a practice that I use to give my mind something to be thankful for. You know, have you heard that? I'll give you something to cry about. Like, have you heard that saying? I'll give you something. Well, fasting gives you something to be thankful for. Fasting gives you something to be thankful for. When you start to be aware of your body's hunger and you choose to not complain, not grumble. Your stomach can grumble, but your mind, you want to choose gratitude. And what I do is I do a Jewish fast, and that's usually sun up to sundown. And so that means like the last meal of the day is, you know, dinner. And so I just won't eat until dinner the next day. But both my lunch and my dinner, or my lunch and my breakfast, I will spend in times of prayer just thanking God. So I want you to choose to do that. Don't wait till you feel like it. I want you to choose to fast and let God fill in the space. You know, the interesting thing about fasting is that Matthew 4:4 says, Jesus is saying that man doesn't live on bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. There's no other creature in creation that can live off of nothing, right? Animals live for their next meal. Humans do not, right? You live for so much more. You do not live on bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. And God did speak to you in his word. And God is speaking to you today because his word transcends time. And then lastly, I want you to confess. I want you to confess that you've been grumbling. I want you to identify what it is that you're grumbling about. So go ahead and stand up. So in your mind, I want you to ask the Lord, ask God right now, what is it that I tend to grumble about? Ask the Lord, what is it that I tend to grumble about? And let God reveal that to you. Whether it's school, whether it's transportation, relationship status, appearance, family, ministry, whatever. Just ask God to reveal that to you in your mind. What is it that you tend to grumble about? Now, I want you to picture yourself giving that back to him. Give that to Jesus right now. Just in your mind, just give that back to him. If it's your singleness, if it's your education, just give it back to Jesus. And then last, I want you to do something crazy right now. I want you to thank him. I want you to thank God. Find something to be thankful for in the midst of your circumstance, in the midst of your complaint. Find something. This week, my condo flooded with water, but I was thankful that I had a condo to flood. What do you need to be thankful for in the midst of your complaint? In fact, I want us to get even crazier right now. I want us to thank God out loud for the edification of those around us. What can we thank God for? Just one thing. It could be toilet paper. It could be water, wells, Tanzania, friends, a house. I heard candy. What else? Yeah, keep going. What else? Family, yes. Car. What else? A job. What else? What can we thank God for out loud today?